We are really for real getting into it today. So we are going through fluid and electrolytes. We're doing this in a three-part video series, just like my pharmacology series, so check that out also. We need a little bit of background information before we get into the actual specific disorders that we're going to be talking about. So there's some chemistry to this, and I want to explain this because I feel like when I'm studying pH and acidity versus alkalinity and the different disorders that come with it, I felt like I didn't really have a basis of understanding of what this even means. Like, why is something acidic and why is something alkaline and why do we need to keep that balance, etc. Normal serum pH for a human body, right off the bat, 7.35 to 7.45. As we all know, there are many things going on in the body. The tiniest things that make up the body, we come to subatomic particles. An acid is a molecule that will give away or donate a proton or a hydrogen ion from a hydrogen atom. An ion is an atom or a molecule that has an electrical charge. An acid has a pH of under 7. Conversely, bases, or a molecule that is alkaline, steals protons or accepts protons from hydrogen molecules. Bases have a pH above 7. Our bodies are always trying to find homeostasis. We're always trying to balance everything out. The main organs involved in our pH balance in our bodies are the lungs and the kidneys. For example, CO2, or carbon dioxide, is mildly acidic. It's a waste product of the processing of oxygen and nutrients in the body. Carbon dioxide passes from cells into the blood as a waste product. Blood brings the carbon dioxide to the lungs where it's exhaled. If carbon dioxide accumulates in the blood becomes more acidic. Let's go over what we need to stay within the range of. pH, like I said, 7.35 to 7.45. HCO3, or bicarbonate, 24 to 26. CO2, or carbon dioxide, is 35 to 45. Partial oxygen, PaO2, is 80 to 100. And SaO2, so oxygen saturation, should be over 95%. We have four general categories when it comes to pH balance in the body and diagnoses. We have respiratory acidosis and respiratory alkalosis. We have metabolic acidosis and metabolic alkalosis. I will put a chart right here and it will remain here for a lot of the video because when it comes to taking your exam, I want you to write this down. You can generally ask for a piece of scratch paper. Respiratory acidosis. This is when your pH is low. So the pH is going to be under 7.35. The carbon dioxide, on the other hand, is high. This is above 26. The bicarb is normal. Respiratory depression, which can come about through drugs like opioids, when your breathing really slows down to a point where the body actually starts to become acidic. Central nervous system trauma, so like a brain injury, spinal cord injury, something like that. And COPD. Many other diagnoses that can cause respiratory acidosis, but those are kind of the main ones you need to know. Respiratory alkalosis, the opposite of respiratory acidosis. So pH is high, it's going to be above 7.45. CO2 is low, bicarb is normal. So with respiratory acidosis and alkalosis, the bicarb is normal. Signs and symptoms of respiratory alkalosis are things like hyperventilation, panic attacks, anxiety, things that cause your breathing to become really fast and shallow, emotions, pain, things of those natures. Okay, moving into metabolic disorders. Metabolic acidosis. The pH is low. It's going to be under 7.35. The CO2 is now normal, okay, between 22 and 26, and the bicarb is low. Things that could cause metabolic acidosis are diabetes, shock, and renal failure, amongst others. Metabolic alkalosis. Okay, the pH is high, so it's above 7.45. CO2 is normal again. Bicarb is now high. Things that can cause metabolic alkalosis are prolonged vomiting, nasogastric drainage, and loss of potassium, which happens with vomiting as well. So when you vomit, your vomit is acidic, okay? You're releasing that acid. So naturally, you're going to become more alkaline. When you have diarrhea, diarrhea is alkaline, okay? Your body is going to compensate and become more acidic. If you have diarrhea, it's going to compensate and become more alkaline when you're vomiting. Okay, that's all we're going to go through this video. There are some more complicated aspects of this idea, and it has to do with compensation. We won't get into that now because I don't think it's necessary for your NCLEX. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you got something out of this video. Good luck studying. I tutor for the NCLEX. So I do 60-minute sessions, 40-minute sessions. I also do some career coaching stuff and anxiety coaching. So get in touch with me. The link is below, and I'll see you in the next video.